Hi, can you hear me? So, hello everyone. My name is Krzysztof Kudryński and this is Błażej Kubiak. And we are extremely happy to welcome so many of you on our presentation about indoor real-time mapping with the drone. This presentation will take about 50 minutes, so if you have any questions, please wait till the end of the presentation. But if we go too fast with something, please do not hesitate to excuse us and continue listening. So, before we start, a few words about us. We both work in TomTom, where we deal with the system design and algorithms. Algorithms ranging from signal processing, image processing, point cloud analysis, and artificial intelligence. And in the recent years, we've been involved in, in a very interesting project called self-driving car. So we were using our skills in video processing and laser point cloud processing to create a three-dimensional, high-accuracy map of centimeter accuracy for the self-driving car. And in order to use such map, you need also data for localization. And to make it available at global scale, you need a lot of algorithms to automatically detect many features on the road. And probably the most important invention is the localization, which is called road DNA. So this is our idea, how to localize a car so that when the car goes on our road, it immediately knows where it is in centimeter accuracy without using the GPS, because GPS is not reliable in centimeter accuracy. So on a daily basis, we are trying to make the car drive itself safely, accurately, and efficiently. The problem with the cars, however, is that they don't fly, and we think that flying is awesome. So today, we are going to tell you about real-time mapping using a flying machine, a drone. And to make things a bit more complicated, we will limit ourselves to mapping the indoor places so the GPS is useless. The technologies you are going to see, we have been developing many months, many hours a day, and many hours a night. And in the beginning, we expected this to be the story of pure success. The story about conquering the skies. The story about flying into the unknown and reaching the stars. And there's been a lot of success, you will see nice things. But you have to know that behind these successes, this should be the story about fighting, about constant struggling, irritation. Story about falling and rising from your knees. Story about determination and desperation. Our adventure with the drone started from the TomTom competition, where we had the task to follow a running person using the drone and film it autonomously. And it took place in Amsterdam, which is famous for the fact that you can legally take a lot of photos there. We are professionals. And as professionals, we know that in order to succeed, you need to plan your actions. So you start with buying the drone, you open the box, you learn to fly manually, gather some characteristics, and then you continue with your incremental development, testing, and adding the code. However, at the same time, we are enthusiasts. And as enthusiasts, we started with the final design. Then, we bought all the electronics that came into our head, and then, we bought the drone. Then we rushed with the development, and it was going great. And after celebrating the first successes of our release, we decided to open the box. The drone was inside, so we put all the electronics that was there, and we gloriously went for our first test in the field, which turned out to be the last test of the first drone. With the next drone, we started to learn to fly manually. And then we continued with a little bit less professional approach. So this enthusiasm and also lack of skills in dealing with this flying piece of hardware costed us lives of three drones, one injury, and countless losses in equipment. But with the last remaining drone, we managed to follow the runner on its entire track, which was a reasonable achievement. However, we do not like reasonable achievement. We want extraordinary achievements. So when the contest was finished, we decided to continue with the topic. And using the remainings of the last three drones, we created the drone of the last chance, the new hope to fulfill our sick ambitions. These ambitions, and at the same time, the agenda for this presentation is to show you our technology, to create a map out of the drone bottom camera, localize ourselves on this map, and use this map to perform high-level operations in context of some interesting applications. We tackled all of these issues with various results, and we are going to show it to you, including some insights into the algorithms that we use, but focusing mostly on the show. So, we started working, and after several weeks, can you hear me when it's on? Can you hear me now? Okay, so after several weeks of work, we were able to capture undistorted video from our camera, from the drone, and we put some books in our office and we started flying over them, trying to make the first map. And the first software for that was a simple manual application in Java, which you can see here. So it is simple. You can browse through the frames, as you can see, and then when you find that the frame is nice, you can enter and make it the map. And then you can continue browsing, but the map behind stays, so that you can now rotate, shift, and zoom in with the next frames, so that the frames agree. And you can continue like that, adding more frames, rotating, and so on, so that you can create the map. Well, the first approaches, using some transparency and blending, were not very smooth and nice, but day after day, we created better and better blending of the frames into the map until the map was much smoother. How we obtained smoothness? So this is a diagram of a drone flying over some high objects, and the dots represent time moments when the frame was taken. And as you can see, in a single instance, that's obvious, that the frame captured by the camera takes a limited angle view of what it sees, and it doesn't know what the height of the objects are, so the projection of what will be seen on the frame is not in agreement with a top view, and it's not in agreement with any other frame. In fact, the only place where our image is in agreement with the top view is the place directly below the drone. And if we drive smoothly, this is just the center pixel of our image. So what we did is simply we created a mask with one in the middle and zero on the edges and going down smoothly, so that when we add another frame to the map, we just perform simple weighted averaging. And then from the two maps, we created a blended map, and the center perspectives are most important, so you will not see what is below the desk, but you will see it from the top view, because we have a center perspective of that at this frame. So using such simple blending and weighted averaging, we created a nice blended map. But of course, it was manual in the beginning, which was very slow and time-consuming. So we started to automate this, and we started with a brute force algorithm of correlation, so that when we have some frame already in the map, we will look for another frame everywhere around, but not too far away. And we will look for it for every possible shift, every possible rotation, and every possible height change. And you can, if you assume that during 1 second the drone can move 3 meters, turn by 90 degrees, and change altitude by 1 meter, you can assume something like this. And you want accuracy of several pixels of your map. Simple calculation would show that for one frame, you need hundreds of thousands of operations to get such correlation, the best correlation. And if you are interested in real time, during 1 second, this would be millions of operations. So you can, with simple tricks, you can go down with this number, but in order to make it work in real time, you need to really choose wisely, select the frames where you want to correlate, and even if you have that, your correlation must be fast. So, in a few minutes, I will tell you how to choose wisely, but now Błażej will tell you how to be fast.
Hi. So, as Krzysztof said, I will tell you how to be fast. So, let's start. My goal was to develop fast and reliable method of correlation between frame and map. And this method should transform process and rank multiple transformations and assign confidence level to each transformation. So it looks like this. It must be very smooth, which means that when frame is going away from the correct solution, confidence should decrease smoothly. And when it comes back, it should increase. And last but not least, it should be extremely fast to perform in real time with over 2,000 transformations per second. So first attempt was very simple solution based on template matching. In that solution, we just transform every frame, whole frame, to a new location at each iteration and just iterate over pixels in overlapping area and just some product values of pixels. So it's very simple, but it's not fast. It performs only 100 transformations per second, and we are far away from our goal. So we did another try. But we wanted to be smarter this time, so we considered what aspect may introduce faster method. And we had two conclusions. First is to reduce size of data that has to be processed. A second one is reuse some previously processed information. And from that conclusion, we derived edge-based distance. The idea behind that solution is quite simple. We detect edges in the map, we detect edges in the frame, and just check how close they are. When we go into details, we see that blue arrows indicates distances between particular pixels and the closest edges. And to calculate distance between frame and the map, we need to iterate over edge pixels of the frame and some distances to closest edges. So we already reduced size of data that need to be processed because we are only processing edges, so we transform edges to new location. It is quite smooth, and it is also insensitive to outlier appearance, which is also important. But another question that we need to answer is how to calculate distance between particular pixel and the closest edge efficiently. And the answer is also simple. We need to pre-calculate all possible distances that we need, creating so-called edge distance map. That map, each pixel contains distance to the closest edge, so the white color shows where we had edges in the map, and the black color shows where we are far away from the edge. So it is pre-calculated only once, and we can put a particular frame location and try to calculate distance between frame and the map. And we do this by iterating over pixels, reading precalculated distances from underlying pixels from the map, and just sum them up. This map can be created in linear time, so it's very fast. And it is created only once for all possible transformation. So for each transformation, we need only transform edges of the frame and just read precalculated values. So it looks promising. So let's see where we are. So we have achieved 3,000 transformations per second, which is extremely fast, about 30 times faster than template matching. Okay, so now we know how to be fast. And I would like to tell you how to be accurate. Accurate while drone localization and creating our extraordinary stunning map of our office. But there are distortions. And this may spoil our map creation. So we will remove them. So we have two types of distortions, radial distortions and tangential distortions. I won't go into details, but I will mention that we need to calibrate just a few parameters in correction equations. And we also, from calibration, get camera parameter, especially focal length, which will be used to have metric resolution of the map. So that's about theory, because we are fast. So let's calibrate our camera. We take a few nice pictures of calibration chessboard. We detect, corners in that pictures. We put things together, and we're trying to make straight things straight. So chessboard looks much better if it's rectangular, not barrel. And in fact, straightness is objective function for calibration of cameras. So let's see what is the impact of on map creation. So this is before. And after calibration, frames fit perfectly. And this is another example with two books. And it also looks much better. OK, so now Christoph will tell you how to make wise choices.
So now we have limited the time of correlation. So it's time to limit the number of correlations that we need to do. And in fact, we don't need, when we have a frame, we don't need to find for the next frame everywhere, because we have some information about the drone movement. So we can apply the sensors that we have, just accelerometers and so on, from the drone. And only for these transitions, consider these frames, and using the fast correlation, check the probability that we are there. However simple this might sound, there's a huge theory behind that, and it is called probabilistic robotics. And it needs over 600 pages for a brief introduction, but we are not going to tell you this brief introduction because it's DevOps and we are talking about interesting things only. So instead, I'm going to tell you a story. So this will be a story about a beautiful piece of machinery which is called particle filtering, but at the same time, this will be a story which could happen to anyone. To me, to you. And for the reasons that will soon become clear, we call this the hangover. So let's imagine that day when you wake up and you don't remember what happened yesterday. And most importantly, you are trying to realize where you are. You are yet too afraid to open your eyes. So in your imagination, you are trying to mark all the spots where you might probably be in, considering the flashes of your memory. So your first belief about your state is not very satisfactory, so you finally find the courage to open your eyes and make your first observation. And it looks like that. Well, at least it must be nice yesterday. And you are able to update your belief about the state, so at least you are not drifting in the ocean. So when you update your state, you are surely somewhere on the coast or near the lakeside. So you decide to walk. You walk, you walk, you walk, and according to your judgment, you are walking several kilometers. And what you still see is the beach. So it means that you can update your belief because you can no longer be close to the small lakeside. You really must be on the coast. So you decided to walk farther, and you make another observation. You see two soldiers guarding your passage. So you immediately know you are somewhere on the border. So you update your observation, your belief of your state. You now consider only the places where are on the border. All others have the probability zero now. Well, anyway, the soldiers seem very unfriendly and they have guns. So you turn back and you walk with the sea on your right-hand side. And you walk and you walk, and finally you notice a tourist. So you decide to make your final observation. You look at him very closely, and you know immediately that you are in Poland. So what was happening here, in fact? We had some state. We had some state, our position, velocity, orientation. And we didn't know it, and we wanted to have at least some belief of where we are. What we had was the previous belief, where we are. It might be correct, it might be wrong, it might be totally random, but we have some belief where we were before. And we were in this belief, we were marking these places where we think we might be with dots. You may call it particles if you want. So these particles were the instances of your states that were probable. What you also had was the control, the transition, the judgment of your movement, because you were moving, turning around, and you were not only controlling your movement, but also sensing it, measuring it by maybe counting your steps. So for each of these particles, you could apply your control to update your belief where you are. So we are updating just by walking, our cloud was moving to a new place, to our new belief of where we are. And then we had observation. And using the observation for each of these particles, we were using this observation to check how probable these places are. Some of them were not probable, and then some of them were. So we were repopulating our particles. So those, the weak ones that were not probable, were probably not in the final result, but those that were the strong ones were appearing there maybe several times. And the place where we were got denser and denser. And this was our probability density, where we think we are. So we could talk hours about particle filtering, but I will tell you just a few interesting properties. With standard approaches, you are limited to some distribution, like Gaussian. With particle filtering, you can model absolutely everything. The small problem might be that this distribution using particles is not continuous. So if you have a really good sensor, and you are indeed here, and the particles are here, so the, if the sensor is perfect, it will say that you have 0% to be in any of these places because the sensor is so good, it knows perfectly you are not there. So if you are using particle filtering, you sometimes need to spoil your result. You need to deteriorate it. You need to blur it so that it assigns a probability that is smooth. And in fact, choosing the noise by which you will blur it, your measurement, your control, is one of the most difficult things in particle filtering. But of course, you may make it a lot denser to be more accurate. And particle filtering is perfect for that, because you might distribute in parallel all your particle filtering when you have more particles, if you have power for that. And finally, what might happen is your sensor may be wrong sometimes. It may fail. So, for example, it might say something totally strange. And then you will find out that instead of leaving the particles in Poland, where we are, it will move to somewhere else. But this is wrong. This is a single failure. So we would be never able to recover back. What we can do with particle filtering, we can assign some of the particles to visit random places, and finally they will hit back on our place, and the probability will rise there. So we will be able to recover. So this is a very nice mechanism. And as I told you, implementing of particle filtering is not a challenge. What is a challenge is to design the state and to model the noises. These are the difficult stuff of particle filtering. And our state for mapping with the drone, let's come back to the topic, is the position, velocity, rotation, and zoom of the camera. So this is our state, which we want to know. Our control is acceleration, rotation, and height. And the measurement is obviously the frame and how it fits to the map. So that's the measurement. We could also talk a lot about state, but this is not a very interesting discussion. The last puzzle to solve is where we get the control from. And well, you might say it's very easy. We have sensors, so just we have accelerometer, so let's read the acceleration. Easy, yes? No. I will tell you why. The drone is controlled by angle. So this is the pitch of the drone, in fact, in time. So if in some instance of time we bend the drone backward, it will start to gain acceleration forward. That's obvious. And it will start to move in the positive direction. However, now, if we compare this real acceleration that we have from the sensors with the acceleration that is taken from ground truth, so we somehow measured it visually, it has absolutely no sense. You cannot compare them. They are different. And obviously, it has no sense, because what we would like to know is the acceleration in the X and Y direction, while what the sensors are reading is the acceleration in the drone reference system. But come on, this is, we have that. This is pitch and roll. This is read from the sensor. So this is primary school. We can calculate a few sine, cosine functions, and we will get what we want. Yes? No. Because we have gravity. And the gravity is huge. And even the smallest error in pitch and roll would make the gravity leak to the horizontal axis. And it turns out that pitch and roll sensor in our drone was very cheap, and it suffered from significant error. So in order to reduce that error, we were calibrating our drone. So we were drifting, hovering in a steady state for probably 10 seconds, maybe more, and we were collecting the values of pitch and roll, and since we were still in place, we knew it should be zero mean. It was not zero mean, so that's how we calculated the drift. And then we were able to subtract this drift from our real measurement, and we had our corrected pitch, which we could use to recalculate our level acceleration. However, it turns out that the acceleration sensor in this drone was very cheap, and it suffered from significant error. So what we had to do? We had to accumulate this acceleration in our buffer, calculate the drift, subtract it again, and then only now it was possible to apply the drifts as the drone flight. And as you can see, now the ground truth acceleration was in acceptance with what we measured, and we were fine. Not absolutely fine, because statistically, the error still was significant. It was, the trend was okay, but statistically, we still had some nice error. What is more, we had a significant lag between what we see in the camera and what we sense from the sensors. And lags are killers for particle filtering, for robotics, everything. It's even better to say that we have random movement than to assume we know the movement and underestimate this uncertainty. Now, this will be a very difficult part, so please focus. If you feel you are underestimating noise, you have to exaggerate it. That's what we did, and it worked. Separate discussions would be needed to say how we deal with height to scale transition and the noise associated with that, and the degradation of noise while we go from acceleration through velocity to position, but this will be not the very interesting discussions. We wouldn't tell you too much about system architecture. One thing I would like to tell, the most important, that would probably be very disappointing to most of you, and some of you would find it hard to believe it, but we did not use microservices. What we used was plain Java with a little bit of threading and state machine implementation working for positioning and mapping. And an interesting fact is that behind the control system interface, we wrote the real drone implementation for flying in the field, for collecting logs. But we also, behind the same interfaces, wrote a simulator implementation, which used to replay the flights using the logs and the frames, which was very useful. If you ever dealt with debugging of hardware related software working in real time, you know it's a nightmare. And with the simulator interface, it was possible to make it repetitive and fast. So that's it. You know our tools, you know our methodology, now you also know our motivation. So let's now see it in action. So in the video, you can directly see the interface of our system. In the bottom right, you can see the keyboard layout for controlling the drone. In the middle, you can see what exactly the drone sees, the frames. And in the upper right corner, this is just the external camera for presentation, so it's synchronized. And on the left, you will see the map. In the beginning, it will be a bit stretched because we don't use proper aspect ratio, but soon you will find out how it looks like, because it's still calibrating. Okay. Now you see the map, you see the particles, the red dots in the middle.
No, so jakieś tendencje do podnoszenia się.
It has. So now we will fly into the fog of war. We are flying, revealing new places, and you can notice that if we are in the same places again, the map is updated due to our blending algorithm. So we know more or less where we are, so we are updating that place from a better perspective. In a few seconds, you will see this is just a nuance that this camera will change for the forward perspective, so we will see exactly what the drone sees. And we see our friends after 10 p.m. are working. They got spotted, so we hide behind the wall, and we continue our mission in the enemy territory. This was late at night. We spent a romantic night, me, Błażej, and the drone. In a second, you will see the very nice thing. We will fly over high objects, and here you will see the perspective. We will get much better perspective, and the map will get updated thanks to blending and the center perspective focus. Also, in the high objects, you might see noises, which will be seen later, because we are using our actual map to position ourselves. If it gets bad perspective before, the positioning will not be right. You can see some noises here. But anyway, we were quite happy for the feasibility study with such work of our system. This was our main goal, and we felt very successful after that. You can walk and enjoy the movie, but this is not over. Well, let's keep it to the end, because nothing more will happen. So now, we have the map, we know our state, so let's tell the map where we would like to go, and the map will calculate the desired state that it would like to be in, and then calculate the controls that will bring us closer to this state. Well, we don't know exactly where we are because we have particles, so let's apply that to every particle and apply the resultant to the drone. Having that, we are able to show you another interesting video in which the drone will try to localize itself, and now the nice thing is that from the beginning, it doesn't know where it is, like in our hangover story. So it will wake up, try to localize itself, and then go to target one, pick up a cargo, go to target two, and land with the cargo. That's what will happen. This is a feasibility study only, so pickup mission will be done manually. So we can see the video now. There is much more lag here because we are using the drone bottom camera. Before we were using external camera, which was a bit better. But even with this lag, you will see that slowly but surely it will, when we start particle filtering, it will distribute everywhere and slowly come to the places where we think we probably are. And the more of nice features it will get, it will finally start moving according to the map directions. Now the map is moving, there is a lag, but the map is controlling the drone and we finally get to target one. When we get to target one, we manually try to pick up. Now, the pickup technology is very complicated. It's not yet patented, but we tell you the secret. This is a magnet hanging on a sticky tape. It sometimes gets into pendulum motion and it obstructs the view of the sensor which collects height. So sometimes the drone misjudges how high it is. You will see later, very interesting, how it deals with that height misjudgment. But now let's focus on the pickup mission, which you have to believe me was needed a lot of patience. Well, I think we are ready to the pickup. That's the pickup.
Yes, 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 yes.
That's the misjudgment, but we are going towards target two, and we are almost ready to land. We are landing, and... misjudgment again. This is so sad. But the conclusions. We broke the glass. We broke the drone. We displaced the ceiling. However, we managed to localize ourselves. We went to target one, we pick up the cargo, we went to target two, and maybe not in the right place and not too smoothly, but we delivered the cargo to the ground. So this concludes our main goal, what we wanted to achieve. And however simple or however difficult these things sound to you, most of you probably expected to see this when you come to this presentation because of the title and of the description, if anyone read that. But what I'm going to show you now is totally unexpected, because what you are going to see is the real toilet idea. If you don't know, toilet idea is when you go to the toilet and you have an idea. My toilet idea was about blending. So, in the beginning, I told you that we use a center perspective for every frame to blend many frames into one map so that the top view is created. But now, what if I intentionally change the perspective to a different one and apply it for every frame? We would get a totally different perspective on our map, not top view, but a different perspective. And if we calculate that for every frame and save it for a separate layer and make a lot of layers for different perspectives, we might be able later to play with that to blend a view that we would like to. In a simplest case, our original case, would be use just the center perspective. Just use the center perspective so that we think we are infinitely far away and we are creating a top view. So only the center perspective is useful now. But now if we move more perspectives, it means that we could zoom in and create a virtual view out of the perspectives that we had from the drones out of different positions. Notice that drone was never here. But using the blending of different perspectives that we created before, we are able to create the view as if it was there. We managed to implement that. The problem with doing it with the drone was that it requires really precise localization. And it is very sensitive to pitch and roll correction. In fact, we only give the estimate of our position. We never gave a precise location, and the precise location was needed. So it would need a lot of development to make it in real time, but we at least wanted to prove the feasibility of that approach. And in order to do that, we moved our toilet idea to the kitchen. And in the kitchen, we prepared the laboratory setup to create photos manually. And this setup consisted of a ribbon hanging over the scene to provide the reference height for the pictures and the reference level. And the ribbon was attached at one side to the kettle and on the other side to the microwave oven door supported by milk. With such a laboratory setup, we were able to create 11 perspectives of the map. We created the photos, the center perspective, and the extreme perspectives you can see on the slide now. Now, if we zoom in with the standard approach, just zooming in the photos, you would never know that below this chair, there is a Spider-Man magazine, which you can clearly see while zooming in with our 3D browser. With our 3D browser, zooming and browsing is available in three dimensions. And although this is not yet very smooth, we are very happy about this. Of course, we are aware of sophisticated methods to create 3D views, like structure from motion, like image segmentation and categorization. But in our method, we use absolutely no image processing at all, just simple blending of images. And to our knowledge, no one has ever done this before. And this was a sum up. So we did a 3-month feasibility study of mapping with the drone, localization, and using the map for map-based control, available in 3D. This was a very hard time, and we were very tired after that. But considering these moments, when we felt pure creation, it was worth it. Thank you very much.